And to the analysis of Shields and Brooks, that is syndicated columnist Mark Shields and New York Times columnist David Brooks. Hello, gentlemen. So, first, this revelation over the last few days that the U.S. government is collecting massive amounts of information, phone records of U.S. citizens, David, and listening to or collecting internet email communications of foreign citizens. Right. Reaction?
Well, it's worrisome. I, on balance, think it's justified. I think the president is basically right on this, and the most bipartisan leaders of Congress are right, that we live in a world of big data. We live in a world of gigantic databases where people are collecting large amounts of information. The stuff that's being done on American citizens, as the president said, is not the content of the calls. It's the network of connections of the calls. There is a FISA court review. There's congressional review. The targets are reasonably narrow. I worry about this being abused later on. But as I understand the program right now, I think it's a reasonably supervised policy to try to control terror and balance it off with the normal privacy concerns.
Not troubled by it, Mark?
Well, to those Americans who are worried that nobody in Washington was ever listening to what they had to say, they ought to be reassured. No, Judy, every administration since I've been in Washington has an absolutely bottomless appetite for secrecy and information and intelligence. They just love it. I don't know what it is about presidents, but that we talk so glowingly about the need for an informed citizenry, and yet they get information, they want to hold it, and the, is what Daniel Patrick Moynihan called the culture of secrecy is epidemic in the city. And I would just say to those, my friends on the left, who defend this, do you imagine the same kind of power and authority with a President Donald Trump, with a President Rick Perry, with a President Rick Santorum? You know, it's one thing to say, oh, well, President Obama is sensitive and all of these things. And I think it's a real problem. It's been a problem in this country. We classify too much. We keep too much from our citizens. And this is an example, I think, of it's going too far.
I agree in part. We have a national security state which is gigantic and overblown. Hundreds of thousands of people have top security clearance. So I agree with that part. And I agree with the penchant for secrecy. I blame it on the fact that if you're in the national security apparatus, your disaster is if there's an event. And so you'll do anything possible to prevent an event, but your career will not hang on if somebody's privacy is violated. So their interests are all over here. And I worry about that too. Nonetheless, when you fight wars or when you're involved in international conflicts where there are enemies, you have to have, citizens, I think, have to have some trust in the authorities. Their authorities have to have some power to do things that they think are right. And as long as there's a court review, as there is, as long as there's some oversight, at some point, I think we as citizens have to say we are going to trust the authorities to some degree.
And that's what the president said today. He said there are protections. There's the Constitution. There's the so-called FISA court.
Yeah, the FISA court, I have yet to see a decision made by the FISA court. I mean, it's a secret
process. This is a special court that was set up.
It is of 11 judges, but we don't know what goes on. There's one side presented, and I don't know of the number of objections that the FISA court has given. I guess where I disagree with David is it's very seductive to become part of this intelligence community. Right. And, you know, because we're doing it because we're protecting you. We're taking care of you. We're gonna make sure you're safe. And anything that's done in that name, we went through the entire Cold War. That was a real threat. That was a real threat. And the Soviet Union and the intelligence community, which was closed off and completely cloistered, and nobody could go near it, was absolutely wrong. As late as 1989, it was saying the Soviet Union was getting stronger economically, militarily. It was a bigger threat than it was one. And George Kennan had predicted 50 years earlier it would implode, of it, the seeds of its own destruction were there. And I think that you have to trust your citizenry. You have to open up to debate. Barack Obama ran on transparency and open debate. I don't see that being present in this.
Yeah, well, a couple things. First, we live in an age of data. What the government has done to our phone records, private companies are doing that every single day. If you have a credit card, they're looking at the vast array of spending patterns every single day. So this is happening to us every single day. This is part of the age we live in. Should we have known that they're doing this to their phone records? To some extent, we already did know this, but we probably should have known. The secrecy of the program was a mistake. I agree with that. But nonetheless,
in other words, you're saying the government should have told everybody
that they're doing this.
But then they're telling. I mean, the other argument is they're telling the terrorists.
Right. But if you're a terrorist, you assume that the phone records are being used in this way. But they still have the responsibility. If they see these Boston guys, the bombers, calling some number, and then they want to trace the links to that number, it seems to me that's a legitimate set of pieces of information that they should have. Now, the second question is, and Charlie Savage, my colleague, raised this earlier, should we just, instead of collecting big reams of data, when they have a suspicion, should they then have to go back and get a separate subpoena? So it's a much narrower set of data. That seems to me a very legitimate argument we have to hear answered.
Can I just respond to David's point about Visa and MasterCard and my Safeway card? Safeway knows whether I bought the Ben & Jerry's, and I shouldn't have bought the Ben & Jerry's ice cream last week. Yeah. But Visa and MasterCard, they have that information, and we know they have that information. They can't indict you. They can't go after my taxes. I mean, a federal government with that kind of power and without restraint can do that. I mean, it's really given an enormous amount of power.
Then that's fair. And if I could just make one political point. Usually, and this sort of arguing against my point, usually the people, the voters, more or less side with security. But following the IRS scandal, following the other affairs, the Justice Department stuff, I think the politics of this may switch. There may be more, people are maybe more appalled by this program than maybe they would otherwise.
Just quickly to both of you, you both agree the media was right, the news organizations were right to report this once they found out.
But that's not
a violation.
No, I do.
Okay. All right. Well, let's move on to another announcement this week. David, the president announced that he wants Susan Rice, the UN ambassador, to become his national security advisor, the woman who's been on his National Security Council staff, Samantha
Power,
to be his UN ambassador. Right. What does it mean?
I think they're outstanding picks. He has tended to pick people who are more staff-oriented, who are more process-oriented. But Power and Rice are they can do process fine, but they are strong advocates for positions. They're idea-oriented. They're aggressive, strong individuals. So I think they will widen the frame of debate. And so I think they're outstanding picks on that regard. As far as whether they shift foreign policy one way or the other, they're known as, I guess the phrase is liberal hawks. They're willing to use power to prevent humanitarian disasters in some circumstances. They were both among the more aggressive forces on whether we should do Libya. That's not to say all circumstances. They have not been aggressive, as far as I know, on Syria, for example. But they tend to be a little more aggressive on wanting to prevent humanitarian disasters, believing it's in America's foreign policy interest. So I think they're both outstanding.
You agree?
I don't question David's assessment of either individual. I do find it fascinating that when Barack Obama became president, that his Secretary of State was Hillary Clinton, his Secretary of Defense was Bob Gates. Now he has his National Security Advisor was General Jim Jones, a former commandant of the Marine Corps. Now he has in position Chuck Hagel as Secretary of Defense, John Kerry as Secretary of State, who will soon have Susan Rice as National Security Advisor, and pending Senate ratification, Samantha Power as UN Ambassador, all of whom supported him for the nomination and for election. I mean, the Lincoln team
and you're
of
saying
rivals,
that's different from
they're loyalists. I mean, Hillary Clinton obviously didn't support him.
Right.
Leon Panetta was not an intimate or a supporter, even the successor of Bob Gates. Bob Gates did not support him. General Jim Jones was not campaigning in Iowa.
So what does that say?
Well, it says that there's a pulling in loyalty, and I'm not saying loyalty trumps ability, because these are able people. I think in the case of Susan Rice, there's no question this was very personal with the president. He likes her. He's close to her. He appreciates her support, particularly in 2008. And he knows she was hung out to dry on Benghazi, that his administration did a terrible thing to her. It wasn't Petraeus. It wasn't Clinton. It wasn't Panetta who went out there and did those five shows. She did it, and she paid for it.
She couldn't be Secretary of State, and I think
that's it. And I think he really felt an obligation as well as an emotional commitment.
Change in foreign policy direction?
I doubt it. Obama runs his own foreign policy. There may be more of a tinge toward this humanitarian interventionist side, but he runs his own foreign policy.
Yeah, I haven't heard either one of them mention the word Syria in public. I mean, apparently the Damascus moment for Susan Rice in her career was Rwanda in the Clinton administration, and she's become, you know, that would never be repeated. I mean, that was on her watch, and she feels an enormous sense of obligation. But I haven't either heard her or Samantha Power.
Well, let's bring it home finally. A political story. New Jersey this week lost longtime Senator Frank Lautenberg, a Democrat, the Republican Governor Mark Chris Christie, after a few days, announced that he will have a special election in 4 months from now, and he named somebody as a caretaker, the state mm-hmm. attorney general. But David, what does it say that Christie is having a special election, which just happens to be a month before his own standing for re-election as governor of the state?
He's an astonishing governor who wants to be re-elected. So he's a Republican in a Democratic state, so he decides, I don't want to run on the same ticket where there's a popular Democratic senatorial candidate who will probably win and bring in a lot of Democratic votes. So he decides he's got a lot of flexibility. He can schedule the election when he wants. And he decides to schedule it 13 minutes before his own election and to sort of get it all out of the way, you know, a couple weeks before. But, you know, he wants to win. He's using power to do it. Is it inexcusable? I think it's an excusable use of power.
Excusable?
Totally on the up and up. No, it's a political maneuver.
What made him special? What made him special was he was a tell it like it is.
Christie,
different, not your typical Paul. Asbury Park, New Jersey, August of 2011, like Hurricane Irene's coming. He goes down there and says, get the hell off the beach. I mean, nobody else in American politics does it. People cheer. He is different. And this makes him very much a Paul. This was too cute. By half. This was a way of saying, we're going to have an election. Okay, the Democrats will have a primary, because that means two House members can run and not jeopardize their seats. But at the same time, Judy, what it means is that he will not face as David put it, a popular Democrat on the ballot, risk his margin. All he's talking about right now is this margin.
And you mentioned that it's going to cost
$24 million. I mean, as you're closing down Meals on Wheels for people.
He was never Mother Teresa. He was a politician.
But he was different. It wasn't such a self-serving. This was so transparently self-serving. Plus, he wouldn't even let poor Frank Lautenberg be buried before he started speculating about the thing.
There's nothing self-serving about the two of you, David and Mark. Thank you.
Love your earrings.
On our homepage, you can watch Mark and David's conversation from 2007, when the issue of NSA wiretapping first dominated the news. Catch that, and don't miss a special doubleheader live with Mark and David on June 21st.